could make a start. Can I welcome everybody to this meeting of Cabinet? Thank you for your attendance. I need to just give Phil Brighton's apologies if they could be recorded. And I'll go into item one, which is Members' Code of Conduct, Declaration of Interest. If any members of the Cabinet wish to declare any interest, please say. Okay, thank you. Item two of the minutes of the last meeting. Can we agree that I sign them to true record? Is that agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, item three is executive key decisions taken under delegated powers. And do I need to go through these each individually? Okay, well, I'll take them on block and we'll just note
those.
Can we note these, Cabinet?
Totally.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Right, okay, so into the Cabinet member reports, and Janette's going to be busy on all of these reports as you're the lead Cabinet member, Janette. So we'll go through the first one, which is actually Stuart, which is street lighting investment programme. Pages 11 to 16. So, Stuart, do you want to introduce this, please?
Right, so, you know it's about it. It's probably more than one to come through. Congratulations, Stuart, to you and the team in the the highways department that secured this investment, and we look forward to the programme being well led. Any other comments? Anybody wants to make? You want to come back, Stuart? Yeah. I'd like to. It's been an incredible massive way to put the street closer together, and I'd like to pay tribute and thank all the staff who worked hard. Part of the cost of the preparation should be was every single street light was inspected. Around the floor made on this condition, and that's what's informed the number of columns that have been placed and what I've been. So it's a tremendous amount of work that's been put in place. At the same time as keeping the existing street, that's going to be much better.
Great, okay, so we've got the recommendations to Cabinet on page 12. Are they agreed? Thank you very much. Right, okay. Now, Janette, this is the first of the number of reports that you're going to introduce. So it's quarter one budget monitoring report revenue.
Yeah, 35 for that. Don't you know the exercise, so we'll all get through. I'm going to present the July report on revenue margin for 2018-19, and I'll just bring out the main points of the report. In March this year, the Council set a balanced budget. This was a challenge for Cabinet as it was set in the context of significant government cuts and increasing demands and pressures, especially in services to our most vulnerable, such as students and adults. Given how difficult this year is going to be, the report presents how we are getting on so far, outlining our financial performance for the first 3 months of the year, the end of June. I can report the forecast about term position as at the end of quarter one is potential overspend of £0.6 million. It's anticipated that mitigating savings can be identified to offset this potential overspend. However, as these are yet to be formalised, it is prudent to report our position as it is. 2018-19, a robust approach to budget management will continue. Officers continue to identify actions and take measures to effectively manage the overall budget and reduce the impact of any adverse projected pressures that may result in overspends. Spending freeze commenced in June is part of this approach, ensuring that we spend only on the most appropriate areas that will achieve the best outcomes. This year, we're already seeing several areas of significant pressures across the council as a result of increasing demand, and there's a robust mitigation programme in place to ensure these financial pressures do not materialise. At this point last year, the forecast outturn position was potentially expended of just over £4 million. As I will report later, this position was managed and we found solutions that led to a positive overspend position for 2017-18. So I'd just like to say, as a finishing report, Bill, a massive thank you to everyone in finance. You've been working round the clock under massive pressures, both in terms of just the crunch that we're facing and other pressures that we're having in terms of lots of requests for information. They've all dreamed about, so a big thank you to everyone there.
Thanks, Janette. And I'll echo that thanks as well. I think it is important that we closely monitor the budget as ever, and I think we continue to be experiencing severe pressures in particularly in social care, where demand is continuing to increase. We know the budget is under huge pressure. I have to say I was really disappointed at the Local Government Association annual conference the week before that, so the Secretary of State didn't make any announcements about extra money for social care. There was a promise of a green paper in the autumn, but apart from that, there was no announcement about extra funding for, you know, for that key service. And I know, you know, local authorities throughout the country, not just Wirral, are really, really under severe pressure on their social care budget. So I think it's important that we use the opportunity once again to ask the government to put more money into this key service. Otherwise, I think given that it's what 2/3 of our budget, it will continue to put massive pressure on the budget generally. So you know, let's hope they have a rethink on that. So I think it is a very challenging time, and obviously, you know, it was pretty shocking for me anyway to hear from other local authorities the number that are literally teetering on the edge of not being able to meet their costs. There are a number very, very close to that, and there were quite a number of councils also with not much, many years of reserves left either. So I think the local government funding system is in crisis, and we need some clear steer from government as to what they're going to do about it. Any other comments on this report? Bernie, do you want to?
I want to echo what Phil's just said, obviously. I was at the local conference as well, and it was painfully obvious that it's not just our council that is struggling. Councils, Tory councils as well as Labour councils all over the country are really, really struggling. and there seems to be an acknowledgement from the people at the conference, but not from the government, that as an effect of all the other policies that are being put in place, austerity, budget, benefit, all them policies that they put in are forcing more and more people into hardship and deprivation, and that in turn then puts extra pressure on the council. So it's like a self-fulfilling prophecy, really. It's just create a bigger dream, and unless somebody sort of comes to terms and wakes up before it's too late, I don't know what's going to happen. But I also want to thank Janette and the team for the extra money they found for children's services. Children's services are determined to make the most of that money and to do the very, very best they can with the money, stay within our budget, and if anything, hopefully be able to retain some of it back, because we are making some real progress in children's services, and we wouldn't have been able to do that without the investment that the council made. So we have to thank the council for making that and for all the hard work. And not just the council, I have to thank all my portfolio members around the table, because everybody has had to have a little bit of pain for us to be able to go and do that. And I think that people have got to recognise that, but we are doing our very best. So it's not an easy place to be at the moment, but we're doing our best.
Okay, so I'm going to ask you to look at the recommendations on page 18. So, Janette, you've taken us through the report and the projected year-end figure, and we'll obviously be working flat out to identify actions and measures to manage the overall budget. Can I suggest we add a third recommendation, that through our MPs we once again write to the Secretary of State and ask him, as a matter of urgency, to consider putting more money into the social care budget for local government. And I think that would be echoed by the LGA and many other local authorities in the country. So can I ask us to add that third recommendation?
Yeah.
They agree?
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Okay, so that takes us then to item 6, which is the quarter one budget monitoring report for capital this time. Please, Janette.
Thanks, Bill. This report provides an update on the progress implementing the capital programme in 2018-19, the end of June 2018. There were £5 million spent, but there's a number of new grant allocations awarded. Capital's also been asked to agree to a new vision of the programme to reflect schemes that were in progress in 2017-18. And which will continue in 2018-19 and future years. As a result of this, our capital programme for investment in our services and the area for the year will be in the region of £86 million. It's planned that we continue to invest through the programme on a range of projects to enhance council assets. Investing is not only for our services to make them fit for the many years to come, but also in regeneration sites like the Wallasey policy. In year, we also plan a second year of transformation of children's services.
Okay, thanks very much. It's good to see some of those capital schemes coming to the fore. I think we should welcome them. Anybody got any comments, detailed comments on this report? If not, okay, so the recommendations are on page 25. Can we agree those comments? They agreed? Okay, thanks. Okay, that takes us then to item 7, the medium term financial strategy 2019-2022-2023. Janette.
Thanks, Bill. I'm not aware of anything, this is quite lengthy. Okay, so over the period 2019-20 to 2022-23, Council will continue to implement the pledges contained in the Rural Plan whilst operating in a challenging financial position. The budget projections and budget gap forecasts are on 2045. There's information there. During this period, the Council continues to face financial constraints and pressures. And I did notice last week that the Torley, which is a Conservative Council, the Mayor's given an interview in which he said that there's no more money and they can't continue anymore like this. So it's really crucial that we have a well thought through medium-term financial strategy. So I'd like to pay credit to the team around me that have produced such a coherent strategy. Aligned to this, Council will in 2020 assume full responsibility for the raising and collection of income generated locally that will be used to fund the services accessed by rural residents. This report presents the Council's medium-term financial strategy from 2019 to 2023 that describes a robust and measured way that the Council will address these challenges via a three-phase approach. The medium-term financial strategy describes what the future financial position of the Council will look like, what our challenges are, and how we will allocate our resources to meet our corporate priorities and keep the outcomes of the rural plan. Where the few strategies to resources Council priorities through additional income. Strategies such as the growth strategy, income strategy, commercial strategy will all lead to greater income in the future. The medium-term financial plan describes how we're currently financed and future changes to this, our approach to meeting the financial challenges and how we will measure it. The financial resilience plan describes how we can evidence our financial sustainability over the medium term to provide assurance to local taxpayers that providing value for money. Our process for decision making is robust and we are safeguarding public funds.
Okay, thanks Janette. And just to add to that, I mean, I think again, just because of the financial challenges that we talked about at the top of this meeting, I think it's important that we redouble our efforts around those areas that have been highlighted in the medium-term financial plan. So we do need to proceed ahead at pace with our growth, our plans with the growth company, you know, to create those businesses and grow the economy. We need to redouble our efforts to look at new ways of delivering services, to bring new income streams into the council. And with the working with partners, we had the Rural Partnership Summit at New Brighton last week, and there was a real kind of, I think, positivity around the partners in the rural, local government, health, police, private sector, voluntary sector, working in a joined up way to maximise the use of the rural pound, you know, to pool our budgets, to pool our expertise. And we launched the Rural Together initiative, which is actually about getting residents as well as part of this journey to say, you can do more in your community, that will help us. So I think on all of those fronts, it's important that we're doing that work so that, you know, when we get to 2021, when the revenue support grant completely is withdrawn, we've got a sound financial footing, if you like, for the authority moving forward. So I think that this medium-term financial plan is really important in kind of providing that roadmap about how we're going to be sustainable going forward. Okay, so any other points I'm going to raise on that? No, so the recommendations are on page 52, that we agree the medium-term financial strategy, note the latest developments in the Council's financial position, and agree to regular updates being presented to Cabinet on the progress of the MTFS. Can we agree those recommendations? Okay, thank you. Right, item 8 is the Financial Monitoring Outturn Report for 2017-18. Janette, this is the Janette Show.
Thanks, Will. Okay, so this report is about what we spent last year on completion of services to the people of Wirral. Spending on the day-to-day, as well as long-term investment to improve the facilities that we use by Wirral. It also gives details on our performance on how much money we got in such. From income streams such as council tax and business rates. Again, 2017 has proved to be another difficult year. Austerity is relentless. The significant overspend of care services such as children's and adults. And the worst part of this, colleagues, is that austerity policies from central government are pushing people through our doors, and we're left to pick up the slack of some terribly thought through and cruel policies from the restored governments. And we're not being helped at all in any way, shape, or form by this government. We're too busy tearing chunks out of each other in the houses. I just feel that local authorities have just been left in a between to sink or swim, unfortunately, there's a few that are already sinking. I'm telling that we'll swim. Despite this, services have continued, and our financial position, while very difficult and challenging, has been managed for the year. Through budget monitoring and reporting, action was taken when needed to resolve the funding of the precious space. This was by use of one-off gains in treasury management and the allocation of the contingency monies. At the end of 2017-18, the revenue outturn was positive at 2.9 million. However, our budget was supported through the use of one-off funding for reserves and advantageous. support is not sustainable as our reserves do not go on forever, despite what we might read in various publications. We cannot continue to raise our reserves, and demands that we do so is financially irresponsible. One of support is not sustainable, our reserves don't go on forever. The purpose of the medium-term financial strategy is to bring the budget to a position where it does not need unsustainable support on reserves or on funding. The upshot is in 2017-18 we contained our pressures in taking proactive management of the in-year social care demands in place.
Okay, that's great. Thanks, Janette. And I mean, I think it's good news that we've come within budget in our outturn 17-18. I think that does indicate good financial management practices within the council. So, you know, well done for all of that. And also, I'm pleased to see that council tax in year collection and business rates in collection are up as well. So, well done to everybody in our finance department for achieving those good outcomes. And we just, as you say, under extremely difficult pressure, we need to keep the pressure on monitoring our budgets and making sure that we get every penny of income into the council that we can. So we can see the recommendations coming on page 82. Can we agree those recommendations?
Yeah, agree. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, on to item 9, Treasury Management Annual Report 2017-18.
Thanks, Bill. That's one for me. This report is part of the outturn 2017-18 report for our Treasury Management activities for the year. Proactive Treasury Management in 2017-18 resulted in savings of £6.8 million. And that's up £0.7 million on the mid-year forecast when last reported. Treasury Management complied with all the prudential indicators for the year. The balance of investments at the 31st of March 2018 was £50.3 million. The majority of our investment activity to 2017-18 was in London Day Market funds. Some investments were with other local authorities, as is well known, as it's all we seem to hear about lately. However, our approach is in line with the growing trend for greater inter-local authority lending, which in recent years has increased. More authorities are taking the same approach as a means of protecting their investments from bail, in arrangements also to find best returns. The figure the approximate figure that Wirral Council makes in interest from our investments is about £300,000 a year. Now, I have seen Twitter campaigns to ban these investments, which some people come to me with £300,000, then I listen to you. But until such times, there are other ideas, and I want to commend the Treasury Management Team, particularly on the way that they invest our money and make a good return for us. £30 million is not too significant. The load of outstanding long term borrowing continues to fall in 2017-18. The balance was £180 million at 31st of March 2018. There's been a reduction of £80 million since the 1st of April 2012. This reduction has resulted in lower interest costs for the council and revenue budget savings that contributed to our overall outturn during the reviews.
Okay. So thanks for that report, Janette. And just again to reiterate the point you just made, the investments that you talked about is the kind of thing that good well-managed local authorities up and down the land is doing. And actually, it's the kind of thing that administrations of all different persuasions do just as a good practice. So this idea that this administration do something to ban normal is really just nonsense, really. So I think, as you say, that £300,000, that investment is yielding £300,000, which can be reinvested in frontline services. And I think that's the point. And just going back to the theme of this cabinet, we need to use every opportunity we can to bring additional investment into the council. So I think it's just common sense myself that we do this kind of thing. Right, I've seen a couple of people indicate, Matthew and then Bernie.
Thank you, Phil. I mean, thank you, Janette, for the multitude of reports. It's something you mentioned in your report, and Phil mentioned in his comments, but it comes up time and time again, this thing about the short-term loans to the councils. This, if we did go ahead and ban that practice, what would be the consequence of the council?
So the money that's invested in other councils is money that's sitting in our accounts as cash flow. It's money that we pay our suppliers with. We can't take that money from those accounts and put it anywhere else and use it for anything else. It's what any good business would do. They make a short-term return on money, cash flow, by moving around. We make about 30,000 from investments into local authority or the local authorities, and make 100,000 investments overall. So, the Conservatives in their brief tenure, they did the same because that's what.
I think they lent more money.
Yeah, they did. Because they recognised good financial practice, really. But all of a sudden now it's the flame of wanting to shine a spotlight on something that's been done up and down the country for a long time because it's just good financial practice. And we would be shortchanged our residents if we didn't do this. So, I've got no intention whatsoever of asking for these loans to be banned. As I say, it's not going to be the £30 million. I think more than to listen to me.
Okay, Bernie.
So, in the light that there's so much misleading information being given around this topic, Janette last year did a really, really good course on financial management and how the finances of the local council works. And I suggest that it be compulsory for all of our members to go on that training to stop this misleading of our residents, because it's not doing Wirral any good, and it's certainly not doing our residents any good. So I think in an effort to try and stop certain people misleading the public around this topic, I think that we run the training again, and anybody who doesn't understand how this works, how the finances of the council works, come along to the training and get trained so that this misleading information is not sold anymore, because it's absolutely ridiculous, and it's no good for the council and it's no good for our residents. So let's see if we can put a stop to it.
It's no guarantee that people won't go out and misrepresent our finances, as we had members from the opposition at that training who sat there and listened to what they were told and still went away and misrepresented our finances. However, I would like to think that when we do all the training again and we end up arranging this with our director of finance chair, that we get more members to come along, because I think that they really need to start getting themselves equipped with the government finance before they start putting misinformation out there.
I think that's a great idea. I don't think we can make it all sorry, but I think through the party leaders, we can encourage all members to attend.
Phil, you would like to think that people who are making statements about local government finance would become from a place of knowledge, so I think that would have a lot to.
Well, Janette, I live in hope. Okay, so thank you for that. So the recommendations are on page 112 of this report. Can we agree with
them?
Very much. And thanks, Janette, for the volume of reports that you've gone through this morning. I appreciate the hard work you're doing with the finance book. Very much appreciated. Right, so on to our final item, which is item 10. The Public Health Annual Report 2018. And Chris, you're going to introduce this, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Phil. This is the Director of Public Health Annual Report, which we bring to the Cabinet every year. And this year's report is entitled Harmful Gambling, the Other Side of the Coin. We know that for the majority of people, gambling is a harmless and sociable activity. But when it comes to harmful gambling, it leads to a wide variety of health and social issues, and that includes debt, job losses, homelessness, drug and alcohol addiction, and domestic abuse. And I think if you read the report, some of the stories in here are absolutely heartbreaking. They really are. Harmful gambling affects more people in more economically deprived areas of the Wirral than others, and it's estimated that the fixed odds betting terminals in Birkenhead make 3 times the profit of those in Wirral South. The risk of harmful gambling is significantly higher in areas where betting shops are clustered in high density, and we know that Birkenhead and Wallasey, you know, every other shop sometimes seems to be a betting shop, and the amount of profit I think that these companies are making is an absolute disgrace. Although the government announcement to introduce the maximum stake for the fixed odds betting terminals is going down from £100 to £2. That hasn't happened yet. And the report is looking at the radical shift due to online gambling, which is so easy to get yourself into. You know, the number of people who've done that, and I think the consequences for them is absolutely appalling. So we have to do, as a council, a lot more to support people. And I'd like to point out that in the back of the report, there are local and national helplines and organisations that can actually help people with this. So I'm asking Cabinet to review the recommendations on page 132, which have been developed with the local partners and key council departments such as licensing and planning. And then there are two additional recommendations asking for a working group to be established with the Gambling Commission to see how we can best use the existing powers that we've got to minimise the harm. And that we invite the Environment Scrutiny Committee to consider reviewing the impact of gambling in our communities. Yeah. Thank you, Phil.
Thanks, Chris. I want to say a few words on this, but anybody want to, Angie, and then Paul.
Having worked in the substance misuse field before you came in mental health, I'm really pleased that this issue of gambling addiction is being highlighted with. I think for too long it's been hidden and not spoken about, and like drug and alcohol misuse, it can have a devastating effect on individuals, their families around them, and their communities as well. So I think we need to continue raising awareness of this issue, but also to let people know that there is help and support out there as well. And I would like to particularly, having worked at the 12-step fellowships before, I would particularly like to endorse the Gamblers Anonymous meetings. We've got two of those meetings here on the Wirral as well. So well done, Public Health, on this piece of work.
Thanks,
Phil. According to the NHS, there may be as many as 450,000 people who have an addiction to gambling in Great Britain. And the anticipation in the field gambler creates a natural high that can become addictive, and the internet then making gambling more accessible, allowing more and more people to do it from home, there's a higher danger of gambling behaviours getting out of hand and leading to financial, emotional, relationship problems. I must declare, sort of, at this stage as well, that I have experience with family members who have been addicted to gambling, and it does destroy lives. It really does destroy lives and relationships. And there's often a common link between gambling and other addictions, particularly alcohol abuse. And rates of depression and attempted suicide among gambling addicts are constantly higher than the national average. Based on all of that, Phil, absolutely, these recommendations, absolutely, we need to support these. And the fixed betting odds machines, the sooner that they come down from that £100 to £2, the better, in my opinion, the sooner we start closing these betting shops and putting more restrictions on the online banking, the online sort of gambling, the better, because it is.
No, well said. I fully support this report. I mean, just as an aside, and this is a national issue. I've been actually shocked watching the World Cup at the number of gambling adverts. While the World Cup matches are being shown, young kids are obviously watching these adverts, and I worry about the impact on. So I think there's an issue really there for government and parliament about maybe tighter regulation about these big gambling companies and what they can and can't do in terms of advertisements on TV and radio, etc., etc. And I was really just shocked by the, it's almost wall to wall gambling adverts between World Cup matches. So I think that's something that we should take up for our MPs. But I do welcome the opportunity through the idea of a working group, and also the scrutiny, asking the Environment and Scrutiny Committee to look at what we as a council, because we've got
you know, lots of levers, if you like, that we can use through our training standards and other services to, you know, to calm down on this and try, because I think it is about, it's about education in the first instance, and I welcome the reference to working within schools and also then promoting help and support for people who have got this addiction. And I think you're right, Angie, I'm guessing it is a huge hidden issue. So I think we need to attack this issue on a whole range of different fronts. So I do welcome this the Public Health Annual Report and its focus on this key issue, because it's something we do really need to get a grip of. Okay, so recommendations that Chris has moved are on page 132. We look forward to seeing those that work progress. Can we agree those recommendations, councillors?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. No other business that I've been notified of? No? Okay, so that concludes the cabinet. Can I thank you for your attendance, and I'll close the meeting. Thank you.